In this lecture, we will look at how to integrate the data obtained from labeled amino acids into metabolic models and see how we can use it to derive information about the fluxes. We will also discuss a small example where 13C MFA has been carried out to understand the flux distributions in an experimental scenario. Using these areas, you calculate the relative abundances of each isotopomer and also the fractional labeling. So, fractional labeling is nothing but the relative abundance of each isotopomer multiplied by the number of carbon atoms divided by the total total number of carbon atoms into the sum of all of it. So, this is the formula for calculating the fractional labeling, and this is basically used to check the quality of the data that you have. Say for instance, you feed your experiments with 20% labeled glucose, the fractional labeling that I should observe should be 20%. It should not be more than, I mean, of course, with standard deviation of plus or minus 0.5, but it should not be more than say 25, it should not be 25 or 30. It means there is something wrong with the experiment. Whereas, with relative abundances, you can find out at what positions the labeling has happened. At say for example, if you have pyruvate, has it got labeled at the third position or at the second position and so on. So, these are the two things that you might want to calculate with the areas that you got from the mass spec. So, this is the general overall outline of how do you calculate the fluxes from the data. So, you have the labeling patterns which I was talking to you before, and I also want to mention that in this lecture we had looked about mass spectrometry, specifically gas chromatography mass spectrometry, and there are also other techniques like NMR that can give you ideas of the labeling patterns. And with this labeling patterns, you can identify them into groups, and these we call it as qualitative metabolic flux analysis. And there is another one called quantitative metabolic flux analysis, where you have a metabolic model. So, by a metabolic model, I mean a small model where you know the atom transitions, about which we will come to in the next slide, and you basically calculate the flux ratio of which pathway has given rise to which labeling. And with this, you can find out the relative fluxes. Whereas, when you also quantify the extracellular rates, such as the substrate uptake rate, the product formation rate, you can do a global analysis where you do isotopomer balancing and you have a model and you do iterative fitting to find out the flux map for a given particular pathway, and these would give you the absolute fluxes. So, here you get the relative fluxes and here you get the absolute fluxes. So, what do I mean by global iterative fitting? So, this is a technique where you know already of a model which has the atom transitions. For instance, if you look at glycolysis, you have glucose to pyruvate, the reactions from glucose to pyruvate, and you already know that if there were 6 carbons in glucose, there would be 6 carbons in glucose 6 phosphate. So, with this you frame rules of this sort. I mean, this is just an example. So, if you have A, B, C, D, E, F as different carbons of glucose, you have G6P that is A, B, C, D, E, F, and so on and so forth. So, till pyruvate you have this particular label, and this is a simple atom transition model for glycolysis. So, like this you have it for different pathways that happen inside the cell, like say for example, ED pathway, pentose phosphate pathway and so on, and with the measured rates of substrate uptake, product formation, you make, and also different guesses about fluxes, you tend to simulate this model by fitting in different labeling data, and you would keep repeating it until your extracellular rates and the C13 data is matched. And the only problem with this kind of approach, although it gives you a good metabolic flux map, is that if you have an incomplete or an ill-defined network, say for example, you make some mistakes in generating your atom transition model, you could obviously lead to wrong fluxes, and this could lead to multiple other incorrect and false data. The next one is local flux ratio analysis, where you try to find out the fluxes through different pathways. You have a ratio of fluxes between different pathways. So, here you just have a particular metabolite of interest, and with that metabolite you try to frame the rules, and using those rules or using the labels that you observe for that particular metabolite, you try to see that so much has come from a particular pathway and so much has come from another pathway. For instance, if you take this particular small example where you have PEP, so PEP here, and based on the labeling patterns and all those, they have identified that PEP has come from both EMP, ED pathway and PP pathway, where the percentage with which it has come through different pathways is different, simply because the labels observed at different positions were different. So, similarly, you could do it for several essential metabolites in the central carbon metabolism and try to understand how the labels have got propagated from the substrate to your product. So, these are few software. So, all this global fitting and the local flux ratio analysis, these are already done using different software, and these are few softwares which can process your data that is directly coming from GCMS and can give you data for performing a C13 flux analysis. So, the first one is IMS to flux, which is a Perl interface, and this processes your areas from a mass spectrometry measurement, and it also generates data for C13 MFA. And another one is INCA, where it is basically a MATLAB code, where you have the full isotopomer distributions. I mean, it gives you the full isotopomer distributions of measured metabolites, and this is also used for generating data for C13 MFA. And there is also Fiat flux and Sumo flux. So, Fiat flux is one of the old methods, but still it supports, it is a very user friendly interface and supports flux analysis. And Sumo flux is a very recently developed method, which combines surrogate and machine learning techniques to find out different flux ratios. So, these are few of the softwares which are used, and this is one of the applications that I want to mention where C13 MFA has been of great potential. So, here they have taken yeast, the baker's yeast, and they have found out the fluxes to different pathways, and they wanted to overproduce fatty acids, and for this they had expressed a non-native ATP citrate lyase, and they did a metabolic flux analysis. And when they did a metabolic flux analysis, they found that acetyl-CoA, that is the fatty acid that they wanted to overproduce, was lost through malate. So, they wanted to downregulate this enzyme and see how the system works, and after downregulating, they found that the fatty acid production increased by 26%. And also they again did a flux metabolic flux analysis, and this suggested that they knocked down the glycerol production, and once they did this, they found out that the fatty acid production was improved by 33%. So, this is one of the applications of MFA where you try to see how the flux ratio fluxes varies through different pathways and overproduce the product of interest. So, to summarize, 13C MFA describes the origin and fate of different metabolites. Say for example, you have a particular carbon source and you want to trace how it gets into different metabolites, you might want to use a labeled substrate and try to find out different pathways through which this carbon source gets incorporated. And the choice of the tracer depends on the type of applications. So, as I was already saying, positionally labeled substrates are used to resolve alternate pathways, and uniformly labeled substrates are used to understand different types of reactions that happen in a particular cell. And for carrying out this analysis, prior knowledge of the substrate uptake rates and the product formation rates are very essential, simply because you do not want to take a sample at a time point when the cell has not reached a steady state, which I didn't mention in my slide, but it's very important that you carry out this analysis in steady state, because the labels have to be incorporated inside the cell for you to be able to identify these labeling patterns, and these could vary with different phases of the growth. For instance, in the initial lag phase, you don't find any big label incorporation because the cells are still trying to adapt to the environment and grow. Whereas in the late exponential phase, there is a sort of steady state that is observed in a batch culture, and this is essential to perform C13 MFA, because you don't, after a particular time point, you don't observe that the cells multiply, because of which you don't observe any increase in the labeling patterns and the labels are at steady state. And this analysis, to you know, basically do a C13 MFA, you try to identify different isotopomer distributions, which I was saying, from the mass spectra, and backtrace it to different flux ratios, and also generate the flux map. And using this flux map, you can try to see if you want to overexpress a particular metabolite or downregulate a particular gene or so on. So with this, I end my lecture. In this video, we covered the following topics. That's the data analysis, where we looked at how to integrate the data that we got from GCMS analytical technique into a metabolic model, and look at different pathways through which the labeling patterns came from. We also discussed a small example where 13C MFA has been applied. In the next video, we will look at simple exercises which deals with data from GCMS analytical technique, and also see how to deal with this data to carry out further analysis.